And tonight,
I'm gonna have to figure out how to censor this video. So, I do media studies. I have done a lot of topics, such as They Live, which I'm not doing for GCSEs, quite sad. Man Like Mubeen, which is a sitcom. Bad Blood, which is a Taylor Swift song. Yeah, anyway. Anyway, there's also more, obviously. A GQ magazine on Raheem Sterling. Anyway, so I guess I'm fairly decent in media studies. So I guess released in 1984. No, not George Orwell. Released in 1994 via the album Crazy Sexy Cool, TLC Waterfalls is a bloody amazing song. It is a perfect example of the structure that media studies works on. So many amazing connotations. And it's just a catchy song in general that slaps really hard. I love it. It's sad, but that's to the point. Please watch or listen to this song. It's f***ing amazing and has a lot of views for a reason. Anyway, so, without further ado, this is my review of TLC Waterfalls. Woohoo! Woo! To start off, the song starts... the video starts with the camera flying down past a plane to some ocean, I guess. Maybe some sea, I don't know. And apparently my class agrees that it just means that it connotates to you descending from heaven? I don't know. I guess that's fine, sure. Anyway, so we see these omniscient liquid singing women that I guess have their intertextual references to T-1000 liquid metal from Terminator 2. Wow, shocking. I know I sound tired, but I've had to work a lot on scripts recently, I guess. This just happens to be 15 pages, so it's not too big. Yeah, right? Right, Lego City on the cover. Anyway, so you'll be familiar with the TLC cast, aka the Omniscient Liquid Singing Women. Because they appear between verses often. And recently, well, I guess not recently, because I wrote the script ages ago, and I'm only now deciding to do it because I'm not getting a Lego City undercover video done in 10 days. Anyway, so, before I thought of an idea that, like, maybe the floating and standing in water could be, like, a reference to Jesus. Anyway, so, after introducing us to the liquid singing women, the camera flies around, which has connotations of the omniscient... I can't speak, sorry. The omniscient beings trying to find a story. The camera eventually finds a working class urban story, which you'll find out the liquid women are trying to tell us cautionary tales, quote unquote. And also, apparently TLC had to censor the message of the tales because they wanted the song to be played in daytime and and obviously, like, guns, like, violence themes of AIDS and all that, it would get, like, you know, it'll have to be played in nighttime, because, like, you know. They live through, like, obvious, like, mentions of it, like, for example, when the kid gets punched, there's a gunshot sound. Obviously, there's no gun, because they can't use the gun, because, you know. Anyway, in this urban working class environment, we see a young man and his mother. The mother is through the window inside the house, while the son is standing outside his black car. Although I don't know if it's his or hers or... I don't know. But anyway, he's trying to reassure her that things will be going fine because, like, she's worried and she wants him to go in. She's basically a ghost to him, which we'll find out later. Because he won't listen to her, obviously. The quote, staring at a son that she just can't touch. Wait, I think it's similar. I don't know, I'm not getting the rhyme perfectly right. It further supports the idea of him being a ghost to her. Wait, shit. Oh my god, I'm so stupid. Being a ghost to her. She is the ghost, he is not the ghost. She's inside and he's out. They're in two completely different worlds, metaphorically, of course. The line after which says, if he's in a jam, she'll be, if he's in a jam at any time, she'll be by his side, is really funny considering that just doesn't happen. I guess it's good foreshadowing. You know, because the whole thing that happens later. The next line is, but he doesn't realize how much he hurts her so much. And I guess that supports an idea that young men are stereotypically, well, and teenagers, are stereotypically, like, ignorant, because he doesn't know what he's doing is wrong, and even worse, that it's hurting his mother, because she knows what will happen to him if he goes down this dark path. Next, the mother argues at him, because she wants him to go inside, obviously, and it cuts to her being outside now, and the child's in the car. To be honest, I actually thought that they were partners at first. So it was like, I don't f***ing know. They were having like an argument or something. I don't f***ing know. It was when I first watched it. I didn't f***ing know. I watched it before I even learned about in media studies. Anyway, so the spinning... So some random kid, I think. I don't know who they're called. I don't f***ing know. Because I don't pay attention to everyone. So some random person said that the car wheels that were spinning connotates to her spinning out of his life. Anyway, it's just a... And I guess it's further supported with her being in the middle of the reflection or something. I don't know. Anyway, so the child leaves as the cast talks about how he's... making money the best way he knows how, which shows he isn't really good at making money, because stereotypical teenager. The penultimate line, another body laying cold in the gutter, it's kind of dark, really, let's be honest. It's kind of great foreshadowing, though. And then the last line is, listen to me, which we'll hear a similar line later in the second verse. And it further supports the cautionary tale idea. The verse ends with the boy confronting a drug gang. Wow. And I bet you never thought that would have happened. Anyway, so this will shock you. The brown bag he's holding isn't actually candy. It's drugs. Did I just say candy? Aren't I British? Anyway, the gang looks at him menacingly while he holds the drug money. Or whatever. Why did I put that in the script, actually? He's not holding money, he's holding drugs. Holy I'm so fucking stupid. Also, if you couldn't tell already, his mother is there and she's a ghost. No way! Obviously, this goes back to that previous line where it's like, she's a metaphorical ghost being unheard by this ignorant child. And guess what happens? He's killed. No way. Put on an American gunshot or something. I don't with an eagle. I'm kidding. So you see him get punched, but there's actually a gunshot. Obviously, this is because, as we said before, drugs, guns, and all that shit, it's not really good to put on the screen at daytime. You know, all the little kiddies, they can't really handle it. They're like 10 years old, they don't know shit. Even though I was 10, and I got into commie. We're not going into politics, though, guys. Clever ways of censoring your videos, your music video. Have a kid get punched and have a gunshot sound effect. It's pretty clever, actually. I thought they just knocked him out at first, but I'm autistic and silly and a bit stupid, so yeah, well, I guess all those three things are kind of the same in some aspect. Anyway, so this leads to the first chorus. Obviously, it means don't chase hopeless dreams and aspirations, which is also a line that's in the song. stick to what you know, don't deviate from what you used to by doing dangerous, reckless actions, such as practicing unsafe sex or doing drugs. I know that you're gonna have it your way or nothing at all, but I think you're moving too fast. It means that you may be set in your ways and ignorant to what you think is right, but you should at least slow down before you commit reckless actions. It's not my best explanation, I guess, but what can you do? The second verse involves the camera finding a suburban middle-class setting where a man and a woman, I wonder what they're doing, you know? Maybe they're just having a nice little friendly, safe work cuddle. Anyway, seems pretty fun. Wait, what? I didn't say anything. Little Precious, as he's called by the omniscient liquid woman, can't resist the temptation of his girlfriend slash wife. Probably a prostitute, honestly. I'm kidding, she's not a prostitute, is she? Anyway, so they aren't aware of unsafe sex, I guess. The consequences of it, obviously. She gives him loving that his body can't handle, but all he can say is, "Baby, it's good to me." Although I guess the line says, "Baby is good to me." Not it's, but I can't. Maybe it's just accent. I might need to change the line. It's the quote telling you all you really need to know. Foreshadows recklessness, obviously, which leads to the next line. One day he goes and takes a glimpse in the mirror, but he doesn't recognize his own face. The plot twist is, guys, HIV and AIDS. Unprotected sex. Big shocker, I know. So he's gonna die. He don't recognize himself no more. Editing. What? Why'd I put that in the script? The editing here is amazing. Oh, okay. It said her. Look, I made this script ages ago and I haven't changed it at all. Besides adding a bit at the end. The quick flashes make it look very intense and serious. The montage editing is very good and helps convey the severity of what is happening to him. And my throat is dying. The idea of him coming closer to his inevitable timely demise is supported by the quote, "His health is fading and he doesn't know why, three letters took him to his final resting place." I think you know what those three letters mean. Honestly, I didn't actually read that at first. I was like, that's just a weird line. And then I realized, oh wait, they're referring to AIDS again. You know, the three letters, A, I, D. Although they're not really helpful, they're not aiding you in any way. Anyway, so the verse, like before, ends with the last line being, "Y'all don't hear me," which obviously supports the cautionary tales that the story portrays through the two main verses. I guess you could say that a common theme between these two verses is that they both have the last line involving a cautionary warning before something happens to him. Yeah. Before we move on, I just want to say how amazing the mise-en-scène is here. Every object is placed perfectly, and I love it. I sound like a super bored person who's just reading a script. And that is kind of what I am right now. Sorry. Makes the song very rewatchable so you can find more things. Yeah, I actually sound like a guys, next, guess what's happening? The couple are having more fun time. And the camera flashes a lot for dramatic effect. So we go back to the mirror scene and we see him in an even worse state of HIV. And also, the mirror, no, not the mirror, the mirror's there's a theme of promiscuity, I guess you could say, because, like, well, obviously, because, like, she's literally got, like, six or seven boyfriends, because I can't really count. I'm really bad at counting. But she's got like six boyfriends and, you know, she's quite quick to move on, to be honest. Make love with new men, obviously. Or she could cheat a lot. But I think the former is more, it makes a lot more sense because, like, maybe she's, what was I going to say? Maybe she just, I don't know what I was going to say. Either way, she sounds like a bad girlfriend or wife. Considering what happens to the husband, it wouldn't surprise me what happens to all of them. That's what I was going to say. It's just it was in the script later. This, in hindsight, is what will kill her at the end of the song. The special effects and montage editing here are even better to show how bad he is and close to his final resting place. And then we go to the chorus again. And there's a waterfall. No way, there's a waterfall, guys. I guess you could say it uses the waterfall it uses the waterfall allegory in a more metaphorical, in both a metaphorical, like before, and a physical way now, because they're literally in front of a waterfall. They're also shown in a plantation, which I guess you could say like connotates to them being like spirits from Mother Nature herself. I don't know, maybe. Guys, I'm sorry, I love Lisa, but I do not understand a left eye rap. I don't really understand it and the connotations of it, to be honest. My only hope is for the folks who can't cope in such an adoring pain keeps them in the pouring rain. I guess you could say that she hopes the people stuck in her grave are okay. In their grief, which I guess could also have more connotations of like grief and shit. I'm very stumped in this line. Dreams are hopeless aspirations in hopes of coming true. Believe in yourself, the rest is up to me and you. She probably just means you need to wake up and be realistic instead of being ambitious, because she suggests we are dreaming of things we know we can't do, but we won't admit it. When did I write this? At the very end of the chorus, we see the mother of the child who was shot, who probably is still grieving, but or has moved on. Her face just looks dead. She doesn't care anymore. She's just trying to get through with life in this awful world, which is pretty accurate, to be honest. Shown by her white clothing to suggests that she's either accepted death or, like, grieving, because, like, then again, black clothes are traditionally used in like, funerals and so maybe the white clothing has connotations of something like accepting and, like, yeah, new life, I think. I think white has the connotation of new life. I don't know if this is a subtle nod or not, but, like, she's holding two brown bags full of groceries. You know, the same colour of those special things that people like. You know, those things. The ones that start with a D. And I find it really funny that, like, it's now now the ghost of the mother's child appears. Like, the physical version now, because, you know, he's dead. So he's a physical ghost now. And he's wanting to go back, and he really wishes he listened to his mother. And he really wants to hug her, but he's dead, and thus she can't see him anymore. You could say it's a subversion of the expectation, since they've just completely swapped roles now. Ghost mother wasn't listened to. Now it's the child who's not listened to. Back to the HIV scene with the guy shown in the photo in the mirror. He looks down knowing he's going to die as his photo disappears. And him as well. And now I'm going to guess that the woman has also contracted HIV as well. And presumably from him, obviously. Or maybe the seven other men that she was But either way, he fades away, and she is alone, and then she fades away too. an excellent use of mise-en-scene, as both portraits disappear, potentially showing them fading away and being forgotten. And guess what the item is that appears below the portraits that have disappeared? It's a condom. Guys, the message of TLC Waterfalls is safe sex. It was used way before, earlier, with like before the skin deterioration scene. But it just seems like he wanted to use it, but she just kind of forced him and pushed him. She pushed him back to, you know, and I think the first time he saw something's wrong and he tried using condom. But then she forced him back into the unsafe sex and then he died from AIDS. Anyway, the video ends with the band liquidating again and disappearing. They told their tale, they're done. Anyway, yeah, TLC Waterfalls is pretty crazy, guys, isn't it? It's a masterpiece of a song, and before we end, I want to discover some ideas that involve terms used in media studies. Oh boy. Cats and Bloomers, Uses and Gratifications Theory. The part that we're talking about for Cats and Bloomers is surveillance. Because surveillance, I'm pretty sure, just means learn more about the world. Obviously, this applies because it's a song about cautionary tales about the dangers of recklessness and adventuring dangerously. The Long Tail, I think it's called The Long Tail of Digital Distribution or some shit like that. Anyway, so I find it great. No, wait, I think the idea of Long Tail is like, because media is all like can be distributed online, you could be more politically open because of that. I can't remember the Long Tail. I might have to look it up again. I'll delete this if I remember what it's called. No, I'm kidding. Cultural conditioning. Wait, no. I don't think we finished Long Tail. I find it great that digital distribution online means that the song can be spread anywhere, making it so that people are more aware of the song and can analyze it. Also, like, I guess with Long Tail, you can also have the ideas of going against promiscuity and all that shit, you know, and drugs and all that, is cultural conditioning. You could say the song uses stereotypes to convey the fact that the teenager is a drug dealer. Media has made us believe that way by conditioning us into believing these outdated theories, I mean, outdated stereotypes. And I guess this could also link to suicide of the spectacle. Sorry, guys, don't commit suicide. Commit society the spectacle. No, don't do that either, because it's a sh** thing to do. It's a sh** thing. So society the spectacle is just like, authentic life has been replaced with representation. I've explained this a lot. I'm pretty sure that means real life has been replaced by what media tells us life is like. And I'm pretty sure that links with cultural conditioning at this point. Genre theory. This definitely applies. We wouldn't expect all R&B soul to be like this. The genre is definitely not about promoting safe sex or going into dangerous gangs being a bad thing. I'd assume. I don't really watch R&B soul, I think. But I'm pretty sure it's not like that. In conclusion to this amazing video. I'm kidding, it's not amazing. In conclusion, with great cinematography, intertextual references, and great uses of both visual and vocal codes of communication, TLC Waterfalls is an amazing song that you should study. You should. And even if you didn't pick media studies, obviously, you should at least watch Waterfalls, as it's a catchy song, and the connotations are f***ing depressing. It wouldn't be good if I wrote 15 pages about it, damn it. It was 14 before, but then I edited some stuff and then it became 15. It's funny I say this because, like, nowadays I've got the 44 plus pages for Legacy Undercover Script that I'm planning on releasing on my birthday, which I can't release any on my birthday because, for example, I can't do it in 10 days. I'm sorry. Anyway, so without any more to say, I do wish the best of luck for TLC, even without Lisa Lopez. Goodbye, guys. Why are you still listening to me?